Right, so this is the last one and the fourth lecture of the mini course. So let me just remind briefly what was happening before. So in the first lecture, I gave an outline what superintegrable system is and the notion of refinement, which relates the notion of superintegrability with Liouville integrability. So then in the second lecture, we discussed superintegrable systems on moduli spaces of flat connections. And in the last lecture, I gave examples of superintegrable systems in a very specific case when we have a torus with some holes. And the systems that you obtain this way are so-called relativistic spin Kaluza-Ramoser systems and relativistic spin Ruzinas systems. So today I'll discuss the quantization of superintegrable systems, of these very specific superintegrable systems that are related to moduli spaces of flat connections. And we will see that the tools that were developed for topological quantum field theory, in particular the version that we developed with Turaev some time ago, it can be used to quantize these systems. So first, a few words about quantization in general. So it's the following kind of non-functorial procedure. Given a Poisson algebra, if you want to quantize it, we should present a family of associative algebras such that the first jet of the deformation is the commutative algebra with the Poisson structure given by this first coefficient in the associative multiplication. So I'll not go into the details. This is so-called deformation quantization. So then, for symplectic manifolds, there is a notion of geometric quantization, and you know, this construction is a very nice tool to construct vector spaces out of symplectic manifolds with certain polarizations. So these vector spaces are usually sections of some vector bundles, some line bundles. So in the ideal world, what we want to have is we want to have a family of associative algebras, and irreducible representations of this family can be obtained by quantizing symplectic leaves of our Poisson algebra, in particular by, say, by geometric quantization. I mean, in recent years, there is a progress in this direction, but still it's largely open problem. So to complete the quantization program from just having deformation families of associative algebras to the complete picture when you have both family of algebras and corresponding irreducible representations. So that's the future. So, but now remember that we want to quantize this very specific Poisson algebras, and very specific integrable systems. So first, remember last time I mentioned at the very, not last time, but on Tuesday, at the very end of the lecture, that there is a kind of, there is an abstract, there is a universal Poisson algebra, the algebra of chord diagrams on the surface, where the Poisson bracket is given by this intersection, not pairing, but the kind of intersection bracket. So the question is, what is an algebraic quantization of the algebra of chord diagrams? Not the algebra of corresponding functions on moduli spaces, but just completely abstract. Remember this chord diagrams is the quotient of the vector space spanned by embeddings of chord graphs to a surface, and you take the quotient of this space by so-called 4T relations that I explained on Tuesday. So now, here is the proposition, how to quantize this Poisson algebra. Well, I already mentioned it last time in a very simple way. So the vector space itself, it's a span of isotopy classes of embeddings of, strictly speaking, of ribbon graphs to the cylinder, sigma cross the identity. And it's a topological cylinder. So when I say identity, it's just any interval. So in particular, you can choose 0, 1 for convenience, but it's a topological situation. We don't have a metric anywhere. So this algebra has a natural associative structure. I mean, this on this space, we have a natural associative multiplication. So when we have two such graphs, gamma 1 and gamma 2, what we can do is we can make them asymmetric. We can move gamma 1 towards one end of the interval. And we can move gamma 2 towards the other end of the interval. And you know, it's, yes. So if there are holes, then we will have some small things sort of connecting these holes like this. Now, on this picture, it looks like it's a commutative algebra, but in reality, you have non-contractible cycles. And so if graphs are kind of connected to this, if they go through these cycles, they're not going to be, that's not a commutative multiplication. So here is an example. Let's take a torus, so here's this is a slice of a torus. So we can, that's a cylinder. That's actually how this cylinder looks. So it's you inflating the torus, and the process of the inflation creates this cylinder T cross the identity. So anyway, so in this slice, you have gamma 1, gamma 2. They are both in the torus with punctures. So something is connecting these punctures. And that's the result of the gluing of, so that's gamma 1 composition gamma 2. So you see it's a new graph that's now still inside of the torus. So that's the associative product. So we have a natural associative algebra, A sigma. And now I want to say that this A sigma is a formal deformation quantization of the algebra of chord diagrams on sigma. To say this correctly, we should notice that there is a natural filtration on the algebra A. And now A is A sigma. So the elements of degree less or equal than n are given by combinations of graphs together with this operation, so taking the derivative of the vertex V. So right. So then it's easy to see that it's indeed a filtration of the very special kind. It's a filtration of associative algebras. But if you take the commutators, it so the degree shifts by one. So then if you take the associated graded spaces, simply the direct sum of these quotient spaces, so you will have a commutative algebra. So here is the standard short proof that indeed you can multiply these classes, these elements of these quotient spaces, and you get the element in the right degree. So of course I made a typo. Okay, so this is the proof that indeed, I mean, this is standard fact in the algebra. If you have a filtration on an associative algebra on the associated graded spaces, you have the commutative multiplication, and it's a graded multiplication. So so the theorem is that, and I just proved it, that's a trivial fact that it's a commutative algebra, a non less trivial fact that it's a Poisson algebra, and non-trivial fact is that this associated graded algebra is actually isomorphic to chord diagrams. And the isomorphism goes like this. You take the corresponding class of such elements, and that's equivalent to gluing a chord near this intersection. So whether the algebra itself is isomorphic as a vector space to its associated graded, I think nobody knows, and it's unlikely. So these are infinite dimensional vector spaces. A priori, there is no reason why they should be isomorphic. So this is a version of deformation quantization where instead of degrees by the formal Planck constant, we use just this filtration given by those Naplas. So it's a good news that we have the universal quantization. So this kind of universal Poisson algebra chords sigma as universal quantization A sigma. Now, what do I mean here by universal Poisson algebra? Universal in the sense that this is the algebra of chord graphs, and then for any simple Lie group, you have a mapping from the algebra of chord diagrams to the algebra of functions on the moduli space, given by the, when you map gamma to the corresponding function f gamma. Well, strictly speaking, you should take into account coloring, but after you do this, you have this homomorphisms. So in this sense, it's universal. So it's good. Now the question is, do we have a universal representation of this algebra? Can we realize in this particular setting, this dream of complete deformation quantization when we have both deforming the algebras and deforming the and having representations of these algebras. So here is the universal representation space for this algebra. So let's consider the vector space, which is spanned by the same graphs, but now we put these graphs not in a cylinder, but in a handlebody. So it's just, we take one of the surfaces. So a cylinder is, you have two surfaces, sigma cross zero and sigma cross one. So these are the two ends of the cylinder. And now what you take is, you take one of these surfaces and sort of fill it with the water. So you take a handle body for this surface. And the action, so this is a vector space, and I claim that this is a representation space. The action is very natural, very obvious. So it's we glue the cylinder with the graph gamma inside to the handle body with the graph gamma prime in sigma tilde. So I don't know, here I tried to do some creative drawing. I'm not sure if it's very good, but here's an example of gamma in the cylinder for the torus with one puncture. This is an example of a graph inside the handle body, again with the torus with two punctures. Sorry, the drawing can be confusing, but it's clear what is happening here, I hope. Actually, I think this is wrong. It's the slice, a different slice. Yes, so yeah, sorry for the drawing, but the idea, I hope, is clear, that we have graphs here. When they glue together, they sort of got tangled, and whatever the result is, again, graph in a handle body. Okay, so we have two things now. We have a universal quantization in the sense of deformation quantization, and we have a universal representation space for the universal deformation. So in principle, what we can do is we can choose our contours C, the ones that we use to define the superintegrable system, and we can try to construct universal superintegrable systems. As far as I can say, this would be useless unless you do some evaluation to some quantum moduli spaces. So let's do the evaluation. So now we want to use a TQFT in order to give a sort of finite dimensional realization to this universal quantizations of chord diagrams. Okay. So yes, you see, I was agonizing quite a lot preparing this lecture, so you probably see this. So I was trying to talk about too much things at the same time. So anyway, so let's return to quantization of algebras. So what I want to do now is I want to formulate the notion of finite dimensional deformation quantization. It seems like it's a silly notion, but there are plenty of examples. For example, finite dimensional representations of compact Lie group. So suppose that we have a family of algebras which are quantizing our Poisson algebra. So let's assume the following. Let's kind of assume that we have a finite dimensional setting, and then we don't have to make these assumptions. We actually will have finite dimensional setting. So what does it mean to have a sequence of finite dimensional algebras as a quantization family of an infinite dimensional Poisson algebra? So it's the following. For each k, 1, 2, 3, and so on, we have a finite dimensional algebra. In fact, we're talking about quantization of symplectic manifolds. So this M is symplectic. So these algebras should be finite dimensional matrix algebras, trivial center. So then, in order to say that this sequence actually quantizing something, so we should have a pair of maps. One is a linear map from this vector space to functions on our symplectic manifold, and the other is from functions on the symplectic manifold to our finite dimensional vector space. And then the requirement is that if you will take the composition of these mappings, psi and phi, then as k goes to infinity, it converges in the appropriate topology to the function itself. It converges to the identity map. So if you will take the product of two functions, it will converge to the product and do this procedure. First, map each function into the your algebra AK, and then map it back to the vector space of functions on M. So then this composition should converge to the product FG as K goes to infinity. And finally, if you take the commutator here multiplied by K, then this will converge to the Poisson bracket. So this is what it means for a sequence of finite dimensional simple algebras to be a quantization of algebra functions on a symplectic manifold. So usually such sequences, they come as quotient algebras of kind of continuous quantization family. I don't know a single example where it would be not like this. And I already mentioned one example. In this sense, finite dimensional irreducible representations of compact Lie algebras, they are quantization of quadrant orbits, and that's the program of the, this is so-called orbit method. Orbit method the representation theory, and from which the geometric quantization in representation theory grew up. So we're not worried now that some sequence of finite dimensional algebras appear as a quantization of a symplectic manifold. So now, what does it mean conceptually, quantization of a superintegrable system? What does it mean algebraically? So let's go back to the superintegrable system on a symplectic manifold and recall what this is. So it's two Poisson subalgebras. One is the subalgebra in functions on M. The other is the subalgebra in this Poisson subalgebra. And the property is that the bigger Poisson algebra should be the centralizer of the smaller algebra in the whole Poisson algebra of functions on M. And the smaller Poisson algebra should be the center, Poisson center of J. So now, you know, on one hand, I'm assuming this for simplicity, that we have finite dimensional sequence of algebras quantizing our functions on M. On the other hand, it sort of creates an extra finite dimensional words, but I think it avoids some possible problems if our algebras would be infinite dimensional. So let's, and also sort of nice examples, they are finite dimensional. So that's the reason for finite dimensionality. There is no conceptual reason for this to be finite dimensional. Same definition, same concepts, they work in the infinite dimensional case. It's just for convenience and for kind of having in mind what will come at the end of the lecture, we'll stick to the finite dimensional case. Okay, so what should we call quantum superintegrable system? The following. So this is our associative algebra. In this algebra, there is a subalgebra and one more subalgebra. commutative. So we will say that it's a quantum superintegrable system if we have the same similar conditions to the Poisson case. So this associative subalgebra should be the centralizer of this commutative subalgebra I, and this commutative subalgebra should be the center, in the sense of associative algebras, of our algebra J, the whole center. So, and we say that it's quantizing the superintegrable system like this, if in the appropriate sense this algebras converge to J and I just in the same sense as we had it for the deformation quantization. Okay, so this is the definition. So now, what does it mean for representations? So the assumption is that from the beginning, I was assuming that these algebras are simple. Simple means that they have, up to an isomorphism, only one irreducible representation. So it means that the algebra itself is isomorphic to the matrix algebra to endomorphisms of any of these irreducible representations. Okay, so at this level, it's very simple. So we have only one representation. So now let's assume that this subalgebra I is diagonalizable in this representation. Diagonalizability simply means that every element of this algebra can be diagonalized, and our whole vector space H decomposes into the sum of eigensubspaces for the commuting elements from the subalgebra I. So this set parameterizes the spectrum of the commutative algebra IK, and you can think of this, say, in case if I is a Noetherian algebra, so this is just the usual spec in the sense of it's a spectrum of primitive ideals of I. Okay, so now, because the algebra J, by the assumption, is the centralizer of I, each of these representations, each of these vector spaces is an irreducible JK module. And we have seen this situation before when I was discussing during the first lecture the hydrogen atom. That's exactly what was happening. So in this case, this subalgebra I consisted only, it was just the algebra of polynomials in H, in the quantum Hamiltonian. And so this spectrum was just really the spectrum of the Hamiltonians. And we observed that on the eigen subspaces, this algebra of kind of quantum symmetries that's generated by the angular momentum Lens vector, it acts irreducibly. And the subalgebra of angular momentum acts irreducibly. So that was the explanation of the orbital structure of the hydrogen atom. So here it's the same. So we have the direct sum over the spectrum of primitive ideals of the algebra of commuting Hamiltonians. And then for every such point in the spectrum, we have an irreducible representation of J algebra on the eigenspace of joint spectrum of elements from I. Okay, and then as k goes to infinity, so let's look at what is happening. So our sequence of matrix algebras converge to functions on M. The subalgebras J, K converge to Poisson subalgebra J, and the commutative subalgebras I, K, they converge to Poisson commutative subalgebra I. Now the spectrum of primitive ideals of I, K converges to the spectrum of primitive ideals of I, and that's the semi-classical limit of the spectrum. So that's when, say, in the hydrogen atom, you have the, say, discrete spectrum over here, but then as H goes to zero, you have indefinite classical Hamiltonian. It's just that this last eigenvalue, it goes to infinity in this limit. So this is the, at this level, and then if you quotient the subalgebra J over the central ideal corresponding to the central character B hat to this point in the spectrum of I, then this quotient is a matrix algebra of endomorphisms of the corresponding eigenspace Vk. And as k goes to infinity, it converges to functions on the symplectic leaf as B of it's a symplectic leaf of this intermediate Poisson manifold T. And then how this vector spaces behave, just as they do for the hydrogen atom, as k goes to infinity, the dimension of each of this space behaves as k to the power of 1/2 the dimension of the corresponding symplectic leaf. So when you have this structure, that means that you quantized your superintegrable system. And you can see that it's natural to call them degenerate integrable systems because this multiplicity spaces, these eigen subspaces, they carry a lot of structure actually. It's, if you just have a Hamiltonian, you diagonalize it, you know that there is some multiplicity in the spectrum. Say some eigenvalues appear twice, some eigenvalues appear 5 times, but there is no structure on this 2-dimensional or 5-dimensional eigenspaces. In these systems, there is a structure. These are the irreducible representations of this algebra J. Okay, now let's go to these very specific integrable systems that we discussed, the integrable systems on moduli spaces. So, and let's look at the how to use the topological quantum field theory to construct the corresponding quantum integrable systems. So according to the philosophy that was sort of put forward by Atiyah, a TQFT, a 3-dimensional TQFT, is a functor that acts from 3-dimensional coordinates to vector spaces. In other words, it assigns to 2-dimensional surfaces vector spaces. This is not quite correct. In order to have a meaningful statement like this, we should put more structure on surfaces. We'll see it in a second. So if you have a 3-dimensional manifold with say graph, framed graph in it, then to this 3-dimensional manifold, you assign a vector in the vector space corresponding to the boundary of the 3-manifold. So that's a functor. So these are the objects of coordinates. These are the morphisms. Say if you three manifold is between two surfaces, sigma 1 and sigma 2. So Witten gave a kind of beautiful outline of these topological field theories by quantizing, using path integral quantization of Chern Simons, classical Chern Simons topological field theory. And then he kind of used the hypothetical connection to conformal field theory. That's sort of I say hypothetical because I'm trying to be a mathematician. It's still hypothetical, but nobody have any doubts that it's correct relation to conformal field theory. And so then with Turaifa gave a combinatorial description of presumably the same invariant. Again, presumably I say, because it's sort of mathematically it's an open problem. But again, everyone, including the speaker, believes that this should be the case. So the open problem here is to compare perturbative definition of the invariant that comes from the, say, perturbative definition of the path integral, which is a meaningful definition in terms of finding diagrams, and the combinatorial definition. And in order to do this, you have to pass to the limit k to infinity. So we will use this technology to quantize the integrable systems that I started with. So how to get, and yes, and then the objects that are the instruments that we shall use here, it's the notion of so-called modular tensor category. And the simplest example of this category is the category of modules over small quantum group. So small quantum SL2 is the following. So we assume that Q is a root of unity of degree 2R. So you can see that Q to the R. So M is odd for some technical reasons. So Q to the R is minus one. So this is actually a Hopf algebra. So the category of modules is so-called braided. Well, actually, it's a tensor category. It has a subcategory of projective modules. If you quotient by this subcategory, what is left is a semi-simple braided ribbon category with beautiful properties with finitely many simple objects. So how to construct out of this topological quantum field theory? Well, we should do the following. Remember this philosophy of assigning vector space to a surface. And so I mentioned it here, and I mentioned that sigma should have more structure. So this structure is standardization. So by standardization, let's assume the following. So sigma comes together with a handle body, and in this handle body, we put a graph of this particular structure. And if there are punctures, well, just for convenience, we put them on the first leg of this graph. Okay, so then we assign vector spaces in the following way. So these are known as Verlinde spaces. The combinatorics that I'm going to present now corresponds to the description of this vector space is the space of sections of certain line bundles over sigma. There is a beautiful geometry involved here. I'm skipping this entirely. There are many works on this subject. So all we need is just the combinatorial description of it. And here is an outline of it. So On the background, there is a category of UQG modules. More precisely, there is a category of UQG modules quotient by tilting modules, and this category is semi-simple, has finitely many simple objects. It's braided, and it has all the properties that allow to construct UQFT. And so if you use this particular category, so let's say that mu one, we should fix mu one, mu n, colorings of punctures, and think of these mu's as quantization of the corresponding quantity classes, C1, Cn that we fixed in moduli spaces to define the symplectic leaf in the moduli space when there is a bound. So classically, we assign to each puncture conjugation orbit on the quantum level. We assign the highest weight of an irreducible UQG module. And these highest weights, they should belong, that's the classification of the irreducible highest weights for these algebras, they should belong to affine well chambers. And sorry, this L should be R, if I want to be consistent with notations. So this is R. So for example, for SL2, these are only highest weights that go from zero to R minus two. For SL3, you take the space of all dominant integral highest weights. That's the principal well chamber. And then in this well chamber, we kind of cut off the piece that is kind of roughly speaking by the length R along this direction. So, and similar convex polytopes for all simple algebras. So, and then one can define this Verlinde space without going into the way how to obtain this vector space using geometric quantization, simply in the following way. We remember that there is this standardization by graphs. So we'll think of this, we will color these graphs by irreducible representations of the algebra UQ and by invariant tensors. For small quantum group, for this finite dimensional hoop algebras, and I gave the example of this for SL2 above. So I'm compressing a lot of material in a very short span. So I understand that it's completely hopeless to understand this if you never saw this before. But I just hope that this will be encouraging to actually read about this. So there's a lot of nice literature. Okay. So this is the description of the vector space. So you standardize the surface by fixing these graphs in the handle body, and then you color the punctures by irreducible UQG modules. And then you keep coloring this graph according to these rules that you put highest weights on edges, and you put the invariant tensors on vertices, invariant tensors between corresponding edges. Okay, so that was the vector space. That we assign to surfaces. But remember, TQFT is a functor. So that's what initially was suggested by IT. It's a functor from three cobordisms to vector spaces. So essentially what it means is that if you have a three manifold with boundary, to the three manifold with boundary, and possibly with some structure inside, say some ribbon graphs, colored by, again, by UQG modules. So to this three manifold, you assign a vector in this vector space. And then the fact that it's a functor just means that there are natural kind of pairings between these vector spaces. And these vectors should glue naturally, in the sense that if you think about this vector as a linear mapping corresponding to the cobordism actually between this vector space and this vector space, then you should have compositions of these mappings being again represented by the same toes. Okay. So there is a construction. So I assume that I don't know why I assume, but I assume that many people here know the construction of invariance of links and graphs in S3. So if you don't, think of this as a black box that produces this invariance out of so-called modular tensor category, which in our case is just the category of UQG modules quotient by a certain ideal subcategory. Ideal in the sense of the tensor product. Okay, so there is a beautiful fact that any three-dimensional manifold can be obtained by surgery from S3. So if it doesn't have a boundary, if it has a boundary, then you just have to remove some handle bodies from S3, and same is true. So then you see this vector tau, it's a vector in in our vector space that we obtain from the standardized surface. And standardized surface has a basis given by these colorings of the inside graph. So the component of this vector corresponding to this colored graph inside of the standardized surface, according to this philosophy of invariance of three manifolds, this is nothing but the invariant of tangles in S3 for the link, the surgery link that you obtain that is defining your three manifold, the graph that you possibly have in this three manifold, and the coloring and the graph that's inside of the surface. So this is the, more or less, this is what we did with Turaev back in the days. And so that's just a reminder of what it is. So of course we can do other standardizations of the vector space of sigma. It just gives different bases in this vector space. So that's both advantage and disadvantage of this standardization business, because on one hand it gives you a very explicit basis, on the other hand it's not canonical. If you describe it geometrically through the geometric quantization, it gives you nice description of the vector space, basis-free description, but then you have to introduce some basis in order to do computations. Okay, so that was TQFT. So that was just TQFT. So far, no superintegrable systems. It was just a reminder of what TQFT is, ATQFT. So now, suppose we have our friend, our moduli space with fixed conjugacy classes around the connected components of the boundary. And now quantization, by quantization, let's do the following. So we will replace these conjugacy classes by highest weights of irreducible UQG modules. And then we have to define three subalgebras, A, J, and I. So the algebra A, well, we'll just define it as the algebra of endomorphisms of our Virlinde space. QG, sigma standardized. So same thing, N stands for actually mu one, mu n. I want to remind what it is. It's the colors of this, edges, and these edges, they go from the inside of the handle body to the surface, and that's where the punctures are. And remember, at the very beginning, I told you that I'll be mixing the terminology, but every time I say puncture, it means that actually it's a small hole, and it's a component of the boundary. It's not an algebra geometric setting where it's really a puncture. All manifolds here have the boundary. And when I say puncture, it just means it's a boundary component. Okay, so we have mu's instead of conjugacy classes now. So we have the big algebra A. So that will be the quantum algebra of observables for our superintegrable system. And now choose system of curves on sigma that define our classical superintegrable system. Lift them into simple unknowns in sigma cross the identity. So in case of a torus, you just kind of lift it a little bit from the torus, and that's your contour CI. And define the subalgebra J as the span of all invariants of graphs inside of the cylinder, sigma cross the identity, for when graph gamma is not linked to one of these unknowns, which is the lifting of contour C from the surface to the inside of the cylinder. Okay, so that's clearly a sub. You see, if you, yes, so this is actually span of all vectors corresponding to graphs inside of the cylinder, and this is the span of only those vectors which correspond to graphs that are not linked to CI, and naturally the commutative subalgebra will be simply the subalgebra spanned by tau for these contours CI. So it's a finite dimensional subalgebra in here. And the claim is that these are superintegrable systems, quantum superintegrable systems. And now let's look at what it means for tori. Say when you have a torus, that's your standardization. Now I'm running out of time. Sorry about this. So I probably should finish in the next couple of minutes, if I understand correctly.
No, we can have 5 minutes.
Ah, okay, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a basis corresponding to the standardization of the torus using this kind of longitude cycle. And this is the graph that's sort of, you know, that was drawn before. In this case, it's like this. And this is a basis in our vector space. So now what this vector space has a natural pairing. Because you see, if you take a handle body and you put it in S3, in the three-dimensional sphere, then there's a complementary handle body that sort of goes like this. It goes around. So you can naturally glue them together. And then if there is nothing inside of these handle bodies, you will get the whole three-dimensional sphere. But if there are these funny graphs inside handle bodies, then what happens is that you glue these two graphs through the punctures. So this is where the punctures were. And you get this, you get this tangled graphs in S3, and you can take the quantum invariant corresponding to UQ G of these tangled graphs. They're tangled, they're colored, so perfect setting for constructing invariants. So you get a number. And that's the scalar product of this basis. So for example, if there are no punctures for the torus, this is so-called S matrix in TQFT, and so-called modular tensor categories are those categories where this matrix is non-degenerate. Okay, so so now suppose that we have, okay, now I don't have time. So so basically, if we have a graph in our cylinder that's tangled to the graphs. So then this graph is an element of our universal quantization of the algebra of chord diagrams. But we can evaluate it using this TQFT map to this vector. This vector is an operator now. It's because there are two components of the boundary. So it can be considered as a vector here or as an operator acting on V. And then matrix elements of this operator are simply given by this, by the invariance of frame tangled graphs in S3. And in particular, we can see that if we take this contour CI and color them by any representation, they act as scalars. They actually, it's very easy to compute these scalars. So that's the, in some sense, that's the answer for quantization of these systems for the torus with n punctures. It's a very explicit quantization where the eigenvalues are given by these expressions. I should finish in 1 minute. So I hope it was clear at the end of the lecture, but I'm not sure. If I were in the audience, I probably wouldn't understand what I'm talking about. But anyway, so consider this as an encouragement to learn this a little more. So these functions, they are actually, they did appear in the literature. Ettinghoff and Varshenko has a series of papers on so-called trace functions. So these are kind of finite dimensional versions of these trace functions. So they studied them in the context of dynamical arm indices, which, you know, these two languages can be translated one to the other. So that's the kind of TQFT version of this. In a particular case, I think it was also done by Kirillov Jr. So I think when there's only one puncture. So then, yes, so then, yeah, then there is a version for generic Q, and it's a joint work with Hadewijk Leclerc and Jasper Stockman. So there is a very nice relation to the other quantizations, say to other structures, Alexeyev Grosse-Chimeras quantization, that's one, then Falk and Rosley, Poisson algebras. And so there is a whole kind of universe in this section. And then there is a good question of how to extend all this to affine Kac-Moody algebras, other moduli spaces, and then finally semi-classical limits, and so on. So thank you for the attention. Sorry for a super dense last lecture. I just wanted to finish the intellectual content. And just as usual, the price for this is putting too much material in the last lecture. Thank you.